I remember one of the sketches that you had in the first batch also showed the different cubes sort of plugging into each other, like looking like a connector. I
Where
thought
the
that
air
was
intakes
right.
were.
I thought that was a really beautiful detail that you guys had come up with.
That had sort of evolved from I think there was a conversation that we had with 65,000 processors all working at the same time, the connections between them. You know, are there a million wires or something lacing all around? Will we see something like that? Well, that wasn't the case at all. But I think that was the inspiration for when we realized, do we need openings for air to move into the machine? Our first idea was, well, we would make just simple little vents on any machine.
Uh-huh.
And we're thinking, no, that's not special enough. It's got to be different somehow. So we experimented with a few, and that business of them being angled so that it sort of looked like they were knitted together somehow. We stuck with that. I think we kept on liking it after we did it.
Yeah.
We didn't think it was too different from the spirit of the whole project.
Yeah.
Similarly, there were some controls in that vertical space between at least the two upper cubes in the front. And we often thought in designing a lot of various kinds of products prior to working on the connection machine. We used to talk about keeping things simple, plain and everything, but somewhere you need a belt buckle. That is a shiny object, something becomes a focal point. I think for the connection machine, the few controls that were there were our belt buckle, so to speak.
I see, yeah.
A place to see something like that. Whether that's really a necessity or not, it's something that we talked about and believed, at least at that time. I think another feature of the design was the LEDs showing through, that when the machine was not turned on, there were no prominent controls or graphics or other special features. It was just the form itself, basically. And to have, when the machine is powered up and you're seeing the red LEDs come through those otherwise opaque panels, I don't think we'd ever gotten into any kind of a product or any other project that kind of thing had ever happened before. It was like sort of a second reading, dealing with a second reading machine that becomes something else when you turn it on. I think that added a lot to the sort of magic, the appeal that a person, whether they understood computers or not, it was something they would see and understand and remember.
Right, yeah, and you know, Danny talked about he wants to build a machine that can be proud of him, and we were talking about this as a kind of a living machine and electronic brain, so the idea of it being somehow, or of the form really expressing some sort of sentience, some sort of living creature, was really important to us, and probably something that had not been so paramount for earlier computer designers.
That's right. The lights weren't just on, they were on and off, and there was a lot of visual activity. And that's, you know, just one more instance where I think there was something so unique and new in the experience of products of that kind.
Yeah.
I think it still is. And I think that there have been a lot of supercomputers by other people, Cray and IBM and all of that sort of thing. I think none of those have had quite the same magic, if you will, the same appeal, visual appeal that the connection machine had.